quite a lot. Yeah, decelerating faster than previous year. Yeah, and we have various fragilities, and Indonesia needs to develop a new growth strategy in the post commodity boom era. I think it is also the topic of the Saturday lectures organized by YNU also. Post-commodity era strategy. And the third is conflicting rhetoric by Jokowi's administration. Rising protectionism and nationalism on the one hand, but several promising policy initiatives on the other. So it's still mixed and it's too early to know how it will go. First slide, we have three lines there. The top is the growth of the tradable sector. The middle is the growth of the GDP. And the bottom is the growth of tradable. The top is non-tradable and the bottom is tradable. It shows first that the economy is, the growth is slowing down quite a lot since 2011. The first quarter of 2015 is below 5%. This is the slowest since 2011, and tradable, which is agriculture, manufacturing, mining, continue to grow more slowly. Yeah, while the non-tradable services, finance, grow faster. Next, sorry, it's too small maybe, but almost all sectors decelerate compared to the first quarter last year. So on the production side, the growth slowdown is evident across the tradable and non-tradable sectors. Usually it's only tradable that is slowing down, but now every sector is slowing down except finance. As expected, mining growth has been very slow. The ban of mineral export contributed to negative growth in the first quarter of 2015, I suppose. The only accelerating sector is transportation and communication. And no sign yet of the revival in manufacturing. So, next I go to the expenditure side of GDP. A major engine of growth, consumption and export has been declining as well. GDP grew by 4.7 in the first quarter of 2015. Down noticeably from 5.1 in the same quarter in 2014, and far below the government's target of 5.5%. Consumption remained the main contributor to growth. However, it shows a declining trend. The contribution of consumption declined from 3% in quarter 1, 2014, to 2.5% in the first quarter of 2015. So this is the major source of growth that is declining. So it's no wonder that the growth is very low this quarter. Next, government consumption remains weak and import decline raises concerns about medium-term growth. Why? Because if import decline, because import correlate strongly with export and correlates strongly with investment, because if we want to invest, we need machinery, we need everything from foreign country for investment. So it means that the growth slowdown in investment means in the future is not good. Yeah. It reduces the capacity to grow in the future. After discussing about the growth, I will turn into inflation. Next. We have three lines there. We have inflation, the most volatile. And we have the green one, it is the SPI rate. Yeah. And the red one is the target. As you can see, inflation is always above the target, mostly above the target of government, of PI. So the capacity, the capability to tame inflation is rather not very successful. The inflation is increasing lately, yeah. Mostly because of the administrative prices, that is electricity, also oil, gas, and then food. You know that the price of rice is twice as much as expensive as imported rice because of the persistence of government to refuse to import rice. So if you compare, I have also here, but the price of rice is twice as the price of imported rice from Vietnam or Thailand. Next, the depreciation rupiah is the blue line. The red line is Jakarta Stock Exchange, or Indonesian Stock Exchange. You see that the blue line is increasing lately. The longest rally since 2005. So it means that Indonesia's rupiah, as you know everybody, has been depreciating quite substantially. But the depreciation of rupiah should not be indicated as a crisis. In fact, it is a key factor in the economic adjustment. I will show you in the next slide. However, caution remain as currency mismatch problem might present. It means that the bank may borrow in dollars, so if the dollar increase, the debt burden will increase as well. The red line, the Indonesian Stock Exchange recovery since 2013 mini crisis, continued. So it's really in the opposite of the exchange. Usually it goes another direction, but it goes the same direction. Continuing indicating return to confidence and capital inflows. Yeah. So the capital inflows in Indonesia is mostly by short-term borrowing, meaning stock exchange and debt, government bond. Both are fragile and short-term. Next, real effective exchange rate. So the red line is the index of nominal exchange rate, the one that you use every day. The blue line is what we call effective exchange rate. Effective exchange rate means you compare your exchange rate with other exchange rate and also with your inflation and other inflation. It is the true measures of competitiveness. So if the blue line, the real effective exchange rate, appreciate, it means you, the country, lose competitiveness. So the measure should not be the red one, the nominal, the dollar that you hold every day, but the blue line for recovery, for everything. You see, even though the red line, the nominal exchange rate, depreciate very fast, the blue line has shown an appreciating tendency, especially since September 2014, the last part of the graph. You see, they go into the different direction. It means that even though dollar appreciate nominal, but the real effective exchange rate appreciate. It means that Indonesia is losing competitiveness. So it's no wonder that the export is not picking up. Maybe because we need more depreciation of rupiah. Next, external balance of payment. It's a little bit complicated. The up is it means the inflow to Indonesia. The down is the outflow to Indonesia. So the current account is still deficit. The deficit is financed by two type of inflow, that is investment inflow, which is long term, and portfolio and bond, which is short term. So after covering the current account, we have an overall balance surplus, the red line. But it is a good sign that we now is in the surplus, balance of payment surplus. I mean, it means that we will not have crisis. But if you exclude the portfolio, so it's only covered by foreign direct investment, it's still negative. It means that Indonesian economy is still fragile because the portfolio investment can go out very easily. It's hot money. If there is a sign of crisis or decline of confidence. Next, we will discuss on the budget. Yeah. The 2015 budget needs to be revised because there are so many changes, so many changes. First is the drop in oil price, different consumption, exchange rate. The drop in the price of oil is good for consumers, but it is not good for government, because the major revenue of government is from non-tax revenue, that is rent from oil and from mineral, etc. So when dollar drop in oil price lead to 4 trillion rupiah drop in revenue, but only 2.8 trillion saving in expenditures. So $1 drop means more deficit for the government. So it is a challenge for the government. Because of that, it changing the structures of revenue. Tax related to oil and natural resources are reduced to around half in the revised budget. Income taxes, particularly from personal tax, is intensified. Tax collection is expected to increase by 30% from actual revenue last year. Income tax increased by 38%. Now into the spending side. Because of the revenue has been reduced, so the spending is also reduced. Removal of oil subsidy create budget space for government. But as I said before, the down in price of oil is also resulting in lower government revenue. And there is a new entry in the budget. Some amount of 20 trillion is transferred to village level, double than previously allocated in the old budget. Still not clear how this fund will be transferred and allocated, maybe through district government. Next, now we have a very high growth target. Government have a very high growth target in the past 7%. Now it's been revised. Also has a revenue and expenditure target is also very high. Now mainly two four possible scenarios. Yeah, if it is not achieved, if revenue and expenditure target is achieved, so it's the best. Economy will grow fast. But if revenue and expenditure is not achieved, there is no budget crisis, but muddling through and no budget crisis. If revenue is achieved but spending is minimal, I mean it's like rumah tangga, like household. Yeah. If your revenue is achieved but spending is minimal, so your saving is increased, government saving, reduce debt and reduce budget deficit. The worst part. If its revenue is not achieved, but spending is very successful, the possibility is that the budget deficit will increase quite considerably. And bad budget deficit usually the main signal for fund managers to pull off the fund from a country. So it may lead to a crisis if that scenario happens. But I think Department of Keuangan has prepared several measures to avoid that. Yeah. Of course, revised budget, using outstanding debt from Australia, one of them. Yeah. So that's the possibility. Next, we talk about the challenges that faced by Indonesia. We have significant global headwinds. The left, we have several pictures showing China, decline, Ukraine, Ebola and everything. Yeah. The right is Bernanke in the past, yeah, but it's a lesson for Indonesia. So the first headwind is global production, and global production and trade remain weak. So the red line is trade. It is the World Economic Outlook prediction up to 2020, and the blue line is GDP. So there is no sign of recovery. The right side is purchasing manager index, meaning how the purchasing managers in a company, will they increase the purchasing or down? So as you can see, the red one is global purchasing manager index is declining. The blue one is for Indonesia, and we are in the contractionary territory. So the perception of purchasing, or what happened to the purchasing managers, is they reduce their purchase. The next headwinds, deteriorating terms of trade and commodity super cycle. You see, we have five main commodities. That is rubber, coal, oil, palm oil. So that's all is declining, and manufacturing as well. The right side, showing the price index of manufacturing, is also declining. So price of our export is declining. So as you can see before, export is also very weak in Indonesia. The next slide is about capital volatility. As I mentioned earlier, you see there are two peaks in the bottom. In the 2011, it's related to Greece crisis. You see now, stock market globally is correlated. So even though there is no person in Indonesia invest in Greece, but the shock in other countries will affect Indonesia. So 2011, we see a drop or capital outflows. The next is Bernanke, oh, not yet. Yeah, the next is Bernanke effect. And the last one is because of the dollar has been appreciating a lot, stronger dollars create also capital outflow from Indonesia. So it means that Indonesia is very prone to global volatility. That's the main message of this graph. So we have to be prepared for that. And I hope PE prepared for that. CSIS is doing research on the capital inflow, Raymond Hache and Ira Setiati. I haven't seen the report, but maybe we will present that sometime. Oh yeah, in the next FKP seminar is about capital inflow in Indonesia, capital volatility. Next, after we talk about global headwinds, now continuing policy drift locally. So we have economic nationalism and protectionism and upah buruh. Isu buruh yang Pak Kris is the main expert on that, the main authority, and I think I discussed a lot with Pak Kris, and I agree many proposition that this Pak Kris mentioned, how they like challenge the authority. next you see this is the major rates increase of 2014, it is the latest figures. You see that the red one is the minimum risk, increase quite fast, or average risk. Sorry, it's not minimum risk, it's average risk, increase quite dramatically in 2014 and 2013. The blue one is productivity growth, which is mostly flat. And the result, the average rate divided by productivity will have unit labor cost which is the measures of competitiveness as well. As you can see, unit labor cost of Indonesia is also increasing very fast. Compared to other countries in the region, maybe now we are the second or the third, the most expensive one. Yeah. So this is the first challenge domestically. Next, protectionism is on the rise. Yeah. Banning of mineral export. I think you mentioned it in your speech, yeah, during report by SBA. Yeah. And banning of mineral export, restrictions on imported goods, for example, quota on several agricultural and food products, port limitation for imported horticultures. In 2004, there are three major trade and investment policy, new negative investment risk enforced since April 2014, launching of law on trade, and in September, introduced law on standard and conformance. And the next is showing a more restrictive investment policy. The blue line is the same, I mean, the level of restriction is the same. The yellow line is increasing. The yellow line is, let me see. The yellow line is more restrictive, yes. You can see it is in agriculture. There are several items in the negative list that showing a more restrictive investment policy. So next, conflicting rhetoric. This is I stole it from Aco Patunzu presentation, Mas Aco presentation, showing two speeches by Jokowi, once in the WEF forum, which is showing, call me if you have problems. It's very favorable for investment, very favorable for integration with the world. And the other is the speech in the Asia-Africa forum. Yeah. So which speech that you will listen? Is it in the WEF or the one in the Asia-Africa forum? So with that, I end my presentation, meaning that honestly, I don't know what's the future really because of uncertainty in the policy. Yeah, because despite this restriction, we have also several measures, positive measures. For example, land law, one-stop shop service, yeah, transfers of the ministry to the BKPM so that the investment will be easier. Promise of infrastructures development, and also several health several social issues that will be handled in a better way. So I don't know. Thank you.